two men accused of participating in one of the worst atrocities of the 20th century are believed to be in Australia.
Is that Fruidrad Rukashangabo speaking?
Yes, Fruidrad, how are you?
One of them is living in suburban Queensland. The other is a ghost.
It's better we leave it. It's better I stop this conversation.
More than 500,000 people were killed during the genocide against the Tutsi in Rwanda.
Do you know who this man is?
30 years later, hundreds of alleged perpetrators are still at large. Survivors want justice.
If you could speak with Celestin Munyaburanga, what would you say to him?
Genocide is not a crime that grows old.
The two men believed to be in Australia have been convicted in absentia by traditional courts.
Yeah, very heavy.
Part of a truth and reconciliation process. Now, the Rwandan government wants them back to face justice in new trials.
Extradition is the best response. If there is sufficient prima facie evidence to suggest that a trial is necessary.
Rwanda has sent indictments to Australia for both men.
We invite the Australian police, together with the prosecution, to come to Rwanda.
Is the Australian government doing enough to bring alleged perpetrators to justice?
It's just a lack of a political will to do something about it. And frankly, that has to change.
We go back to Rwanda in search of answers. Frida Umahosa is visiting a school in Melbourne to talk to teenagers about genocide.
We've got to connect you to the internet.
At just 14, she was the only member of her family to survive Rwanda's 1994 genocide against its Tutsi minority.
Can you please put your hands together and welcome Frida?
Good afternoon.
Frida first learned the Tutsis were hated when she started school.
Every 3 months, every term, the beginning of the term, the principal of the school will come into every class and count how many Tutsis and how many Hutus are in that class. And we were made fun of. We were called snakes, we were called cockroaches. So really, we were less than human beings to them.
Belgium, the former colonial power, favoured Rwanda's minority Tutsi ethnic group over the majority Hutus, and there'd been long-standing tension and violence between the two.
Rwandan officials say the plane was shot down.
The assassination of Rwanda's Hutu president Juvenal Habyarimana in April 1994 was the catalyst for genocide. Hutu militia and civilians murdered their Tutsi neighbours, as well as many moderate Hutus. Nothing and nowhere was sacred in this state-sponsored genocide.
Okay.
Four Corners was reporting on the massacres.
It's very, very hard to comprehend what it's like to be here. It's very, very hard to be here.
You do not know what feeling you have, knowing that few hours from now, you're gonna die. They finished killing our neighbors, and then they got to us. You could choose. Do you want to be killed with a machete, a club, or a knife, or a big tree with nails? And I picked a young man with a club. And I said, please don't use a machete on me. The one image that tormented me for years was my mother's head being chopped off. Once he hit me, I lost my consciousness. I didn't wake up until everybody had died and they are burying. Long story short, I made it out on my own. So ladies and gentlemen, that's my story, and God bless all of you.
At least two-thirds of Rwanda's Tutsi population, more than 500,000 people, were killed in just over 100 days. It only ended when a Tutsi rebel army took control of the country. Survivors had to rebuild their lives, knowing that some of the people who committed these crimes escaped justice.
Are these people, do they watch us? Do they know where we are? So a lot of people live with monsters in their lives, in their sleep, in their everyday life.
After the genocide ended in July 1994, up to 2 million people fled Rwanda, including an unknown number of the killers. I've been told that two alleged perpetrators are here in Australia.
You say you don't drink any, no milk, nothing.
No milk.
No. One came from the same district in southern Rwanda as Frida, and I want to ask her about him.
Thank you very much.
Frida, we've obtained a copy of this 2017 indictment. This was sent by the Rwandan government to the Australian government. It's an indictment and an international arrest warrant for a man called Celestin Manyaburanga.
Yeah.
Celestin Manyaburanga was from Nyanza.
Yeah.
Which is the district in Rwanda where you were from.
Yeah.
It says now that he's in Canberra. We can't find him. We're interested if you could look at that document to see if anything in there is familiar and if anything you recognise.
The indictment alleges that Manyaburanga set up a roadblock with soldiers in a neighbourhood called Hanaka, where at least 20 Tutsis were killed with traditional weapons like machetes and clubs.
Yeah, and I know Vanessa Ruggiero because the extended family of mine.
That's a family member of yours?
Yeah.
I appreciate it's very difficult to write, I'm sorry.
It is.
Frida didn't know Manyaburanga. He wasn't involved in the attack on her family. But she knows many other survivors who come from the Anza.
Hello, Murao Mama Citro.
She's speaking to a school friend's mum.
Manyaburanga.
She wasn't an eyewitness, but she's heard the allegations. Frida's told that Manyaburanga used to be the headmaster of a local school, that he may have absconded while waiting for his trial in a community court, which later sentenced him to life imprisonment. I want to learn more about the allegations, so we're going to Rwanda. Pursuing justice for crimes committed by tens of thousands of people hasn't been straightforward.
How do you plead to count one, genocide?
Je plaide non coupable.
The major players were hunted down and prosecuted at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. It took two decades to convict 61 people. In In Rwanda, the justice system simply couldn't cope with tens of thousands of alleged perpetrators held for years without trial in overflowing jails.
Over there are lavatories, perhaps two of them, and I'm told there's two more upstairs. That's for 8,000 people. It's the most extraordinary scene I've ever seen in my life, and I hope I never see anything like it again.
So it adopted a radically different approach to justice, based on its own system of traditional community courts. They were known as gachacha, or grass courts, and they emphasised forgiveness and reconciliation as much as justice and punishment. There were no lawyers, and anyone could speak up for or against the accused, with frequent interruptions. The verdict was decided by a panel of lay judges elected by their own communities. By the time they concluded in 2012, more than 12,000 gachacha courts had tried over a million cases. Critics in the West argued it was often rough and rushed justice. But Rwandan President Paul Kagame doesn't think much of foreign critics.
They don't care about what happens to you, as they didn't care during the genocide.
So when someone starts to lecture you on the international standards of justice...
I cannot accept any lecture from any of these people.
Rwanda's search for justice is complicated by its history and its president.
We've been saying if the ceasefire doesn't have any meaning... If
in 1994, Paul Kagame was seen as Rwanda's saviour. He commanded the rebel Tutsi army that ended the genocide. Ever since, Rwanda has been a de facto one-party state, ruled by the Rwandan Patriotic Front and its leader. He's been accused of imposing a so-called victor's justice, pursuing genocide suspects while consistently failing to prosecute crimes committed by his own army. Tens of thousands of Hutus were also killed by Kagame's troops in retaliatory attacks, such as the infamous Kabeho massacre in 1995, photographed by Australian artist George Gittoes. Kagame's government has brought stability and significant economic development to Rwanda. But elections are marred by intimidation and fraud. Journalists have been jailed.
Do you hold any hope that you will see your brothers alive?
And dissidents say they're being pursued, even on the other side of the world.
Again, I don't think there's any hope to find them alive.
So we're treating the allegations against both men in our investigation carefully. Local journalist Mike A. Urenzwenimana is helping with our investigation into the alleged perpetrators believed to be in Australia.
So this school is called Hanika. It's the school where Munyaburanga was headmaster.
This is the school here?
Yes.
These buildings?
Yes. This is the area where Munyaburanga lived.
We're on our way to meet a woman who once attended Munyaburanga school.
Yeah, this is the way where it's family.
Hello, Goretti. Sorry we are late to keep you waiting, I apologise. It's nice to see you. How are you? You're very well.
Yeah.
Marie Goretti Uwasenga was only 12 years old when the killing started. She says 14 members of her family were murdered during the genocide. She's invited her mother, her aunt, and her cousin to talk about the former headmaster.
atekereza ko yari umuntu w'umuturanye ariko tubira umuturanye mubi.
Goretti recognizes many of the names in Munyabaranga's indictment.
Joseph Nyagapfizi, my uncle, my brother, Alphonse Karimera, my brother, Murikinka Stefano, daddy wanjye.
This is your father?
Yes. Hariho n'abandi ahubwo batariho.
Goretti claims Munyabaranga was in charge of the nearby roadblock and personally led attacks. This isn't something that's mentioned in the indictment.
Can you tell me how Munyabaranga did this? How did he make these people do what he wanted them to do?
Munyabaranga agategeka ni mumwice cyangwa ni mumureke. Uwo bashaka ngo ni mumurangirize. Ni nawe wahitagamo bakwicisha ubuhiri cyangwa gutemagure n'imbunda cyangwa bakakurasa. Kuko yari afite n'imbunda Munyabaranga.
Ari kubaza ngo wabimenye ute?
Nabimenye kuko nari mu bahigwaga. Yarashakishaga ukaba wishe nk'ubu nimba nishe nkano ruguru mu masaka nararebaga nubwo atabaga yamvumbuye ngo mbone.
Goretti's cousin Charlotte says she also witnessed Munyabaranga giving orders.
Munyabaranga icyo navugaho n'umucanyi yaraduhemukiye cyane. Nkanjye hari musaza wanjye yashoreye ndeba batangira kumukubita ndeba. Bamukubise inkoni hano mu bitugu amaraso arataruka yikubita hasi ubwo nibwo nahise nibukanka nanjye ndahunga.
If you could speak with Celestin Munyabaranga, what would you say to him? If Munyabaranga was brought back to Rwanda and went before a court, would you be prepared to give evidence against him?
Yes.
I want to meet one of the perpetrators named in the indictment, a man who was involved in the killing of Goretti's family.
Oya ntangorane nta kibazo rwose.
Manase Musabimiana says he didn't see his former headmaster kill anyone, but it was Munyabaranga who recruited him to man the roadblock where most of the killing took place.
Okay, we sit here?
Yeah.
Okay. This is a document sent to the Australian government, and they say your name here, Manasseh.
Yes.
And they say that you, with Celestin and other Interahamwe, looked for Tutsis. Yeah. Do you remember these people?
Yeah, of course.
What do you know about these people?
Both in the bars. Both.
This is Goretti's family?
Yego, Niyo. Uyo ni papawe. Uyu ni musaza we, uyu ni se wabo, uyu ni se wabo, uyu ni musaza we, uyu ni musaza we, uyu ni se wabo.
And you participated in killing these people?
Baba, bose mu byo nireze birimo.
Did you personally kill any of these people?
Oya, ariko byabaye tubireba.
Manasseh says he spent 20 years in prison after being tried in Gacaca.
Thank you, sir.
Munyabaranga isn't the only wanted man we've come here to investigate. Rwanda is seeking another alleged perpetrator in Australia, and it's someone Mike A has already reported on for a local news outlet.
How did you first find out there was an alleged genocide living in Australia?
There's someone living in Australia.
one community in Australia.
Back in 2020, Mike A says he got a tip-off about a man called Frodward Rukashangabo.
Look, this is my story, look. This is the photo of him before genocide. And this is the recent one.
We've obtained even more recent pictures of Rukashangabo in Australia. Mike A learned that he used to be a district school inspector, another educated and respected man who's now accused of being involved in several murders in his community during the very first days of the genocide. In Brisbane, he's now a driving instructor. We know he emigrated to Australia on a humanitarian visa in 2009 and that he's well known within Queensland's small Rwandan community. Like Munyaburunga, we've been told Rukashangabo was convicted in absentia by a Gacaca court. We want to find out what evidence emerged during his trial. Riverian Iriarurunga was one of the five lay judges known as Inyagu Mugayo, or persons of integrity, who would decide whether Rukashangabo was innocent or guilty. He says he oversaw hundreds of trials. We want to know what he remembers about Rukashangabo's.
So this is testimony from survivors or perpetrators, or who is giving this testimony?
These are the original handwritten notes he took as witnesses testified, some of them more than 20 years ago. But the notes are incomplete, and Riverian sometimes relies on his memories of the trial. The former lay judge says Rukashangabo was accused of six murders during his Gacaca trial. He heard testimony accusing the former school inspector of leading attacks.
Did people see him give orders? How many witnesses gave evidence against Rukashangabo? Did anybody speak in Rukashangabo's defence?
Experts say that's not uncommon for in absentia cases. We've tracked down one of the perpetrators who testified against Rukashangabo.
Bite.
This is
Ejit. I'm pleased to meet you. How are you?
Alphonse Hatika Kamana was convicted over a murder he says happened on Rukashangabo's orders and sentenced to 7 years in prison.
Thank you. Was it important for you that you took responsibility and accepted what you'd done?
Alphonse claims that after the Hutu president was assassinated, Rukashangabo targeted men he accused of spying for the Tutsi rebels. 2 days later, Alphonse alleges Rukashangabo led a mob that caught a father and son, Deo and Gilbert, and beat them to death.
When you beat Bizimungu, you hit him with your fists or with a stick? How did you beat him?
Kubisa inkoni nk'eshatu
nikuno nurikisha ngo batibye ndibihagira mu kubita inkoni mu mutwe baraguye ubwa mu kubita inkoni abaraguye.
He claims other men in the mob continued to beat Bizimungu.
Nuko barapfuye tu.
Aho yarapfuye.
Eh yarapfuye.
Yeah.
Kuko nubundi iyo bitabaho kuzuzamo n'abari abantu b'abayobozi nubundi umuturage ubwe ntabwo yari buze gufata icyemezo ngo ngiye kwica umuturanyi runaka ntabwo byari bushoboke birababaje kuba nta gihano nawe afite.
Baje kubukeye mu gitondo nibwo basanze murumuna wanjye nyine.
Yoweri Gatoyiha was Bizimungu's older brother. He didn't witness the killing.
Kuburyo twamukuye mu musarani hariya bari bamujugunye mu musarani pfari.
How many members of your family died in the genocide?
Bose nshize hamwe bose n'abantu 24.
Can I show you these photographs? And can I ask you, do you know who this man is?
You need to check on Gabon now, Undi. I knew. Knew where it goes.
After months of negotiation, we've finally been granted access to the official court records from Rukashangabo's trial in 2007. The Gacaca archive is kept in the Ministry of National Unity and Civic Engagement in the capital, Kigali.
So this is one of 8 rooms. I have told you that we have more than 8 rooms of archives. So this, we have 9 districts in this room, including Goma. So we are looking for Cheshangabo case, which is among around here. Yeah, this is the box.
This
Yes.
Rukashangabo's file is in
exactly
here.
Exactly, falls here.
Oh, okay. We so can take it down?
We can take it down. It's very heavy.
Okay, okay.
And then you go up there.
Oh, yeah, very heavy. Okay. All right, so the case could be in any of these
in
files.
In any of these books, yes. We have to go through all the books.
So we search.
We search, you read, you'll be looking for the name.
Oh,
Rwanda, yes.
It's not easy.
It's not easy.
I can see why this would take a long time. Sense of the history, of a first draft of history, reading through these books. And somewhere in these pages, somewhere in this box, is the record of the alleged activities of a man who now lives in suburban Brisbane. We are going well. We have found.
And you remember Rumuri King of
Hostage? Yeah. We just haven't found Rukashangabo.
Oh, we find it.
Here he is.
Yeah.
Rukashangabo Fruidward, born in 1956.
Oh,
here it is.
Find it.
Extraordinary. Vassons, we have found him. I'd been warned not to expect anything that reads like an Australian court transcript. It's not always a complete record of a trial, and the evidence often emerges over several years and across different trials.
This is a witness giving their statement?
Yes, they give the statement.
In the two pages we find about Rukashangabo, I don't see any mention of Alphonse or Bizimungu, the man he says Rukashangabo ordered him to attack. But many of the names we've been told about are here, including Deo and Gilbert, the father and son allegedly killed before Bizimungu.
And his Riverian, the one who talked to us.
Ah, here's Riverian.
We can't find any reference to Rukashangabo leading the genocide in his community. But at least 10 alleged victims are listed here, several more than the former lay judge mentioned. We're still looking for the verdict.
Here we go.
I got it.
You got it?
Yes.
Well,
got
found
the judgment.
What does the judgment say?
Yes. They say that after the sitting, after the bench sitting, they found that Rukashangabo was guilty and they have sentenced him 30 years of imprisonment.
30 years.
Yeah, we are done.
In November 2007, Frodouard Rukashangabo was found guilty in the Gacaca court of being well known for murder, dragging dead bodies and burning them. The conviction does not record which deaths he was held responsible for. Rwandan prosecutors say that anyone already convicted in Gacaca will be entitled to a fresh trial if they're extradited. Rwanda's National Public Prosecution Authority says it has pursued more than 1,100 genocide suspects across 33 countries. What have they done about the two Rwandans we're investigating?
Yes, hello.
Mr. Simeon Toure, thanks so much for making the time to meet with me today.
Welcome.
Much appreciated. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Prosecutor John Bosco Simeon Toure has led Rwanda's genocide fugitive tracking unit for more than a decade. I ask him about Celestin Munyabaranga, whose indictment for at least 21 alleged murders was sent to Australia in 2017.
We invite the Australian police, together with the prosecution, to come to Rwanda because it's where the crime scene is located. It's where witnesses will be found. This is an issue of an international nature. This is genocide.
What ultimately happened in his Gacaca court trial?
So his case was tried in his absence, and he was actually on 13th of May 2008. He was convicted to life imprisonment by the court of Busasamana. So we have identified another fugitive in Australia. In the names of Frodouard Rukashangabo, and we did our thorough investigations. We came up with a decision of indicting him.
Four Corners has confirmed that an indictment for Rukashangabo was received by the Australian government in January. We haven't seen it.
We will leave no stone unturned until justice is done. When a country is not prosecuting a genocide case, when it has been asked to do so, it should know that it is giving safe haven to other perpetrators to come and enjoy that safe haven. It beats every sensible person's understanding. And they need to face the law.
President Kagame has been accused of using the search for genocide suspects to attack his political enemies abroad. We've learned of two Rwandan men living in New Zealand, both significant political players in the pre-genocide regime who've been accused of crimes by Rwandan prosecutors. But according to documents we've seen, when authorities in New Zealand investigated, they found there was no case to answer. Before I head back to find out what the Australian government knows about these cases, there are a couple of people I want to meet here in London. Has the Rwandan government politicised, even weaponised, allegations of genocide to pursue political enemies?
The fact that we've also seen Rwandan government assassinations of political opponents abroad, the sometimes violent infiltration of diaspora communities, that activity alongside the pursuit of genocide fugitives, I think raises all sorts of concerns about the justice process. And actually, I tend to think that the justice process is quite robust. I think the Genocide Fugitive Tracking Unit tends to act more often than not when it has pretty robust evidentiary reasons to pursue certain suspects.
But Australian Dr. Phil Clark is a professor of international politics and has spent two decades studying the Gacaca courts. His wife, Dr. Nicola Palmer, teaches international criminal law and tracks the Rwandan government's pursuit of genocide suspects around the globe. How robust are these trials from a legal point of view?
I think the information that they provide is as robust as any other testimony. If you spoke in Gacaca, you spoke under your own name, you were immediately recognised, and so you really had to be able to defend what it was that you said.
But critics, including Human Rights Watch, have argued that a fair trial wasn't guaranteed at Gacaca. They focus on the lack of legal representation for the accused, the potential for corruption, and the use of hearsay evidence.
I think one of the interesting things here is that international lawyers and international human rights groups hated Gacaca at the outset. And yet almost every international trial that relates to Rwandan genocide cases has ended up using Gacaca evidence. This was a system that tested evidence, that led to a 30% acquittal rate, that was in some ways often heavily skewed towards the genocide suspect, because most of the judges in question were Hutu. Even in those in absentia cases, it didn't guarantee that these individuals would be found guilty. In fact, we have plenty of evidence to suggest it was possible to defend yourself even from a distance.
Australia's received one indictment from the Rwandan government. It may receive more in the future. How should countries like Australia respond to those indictments?
My own sense is that extradition is the best response in these cases. If there is sufficient prima facie evidence to suggest that a trial is necessary. But if that is not possible for all sorts of reasons, then I think it's the responsibility of those host countries, like Australia, to find a way to deal with these cases through their own courts.
I think one has to be cautious, as we've said, around the evidence that is initially presented in the indictment, but I do think it prompts and warrants further investigation.
If you were a poor peasant farmer accused of genocide crimes on the Rwandan hills, you got prosecuted through Gacaca. But there's been a completely different process for those who were wealthy enough to escape the country. Most of them have avoided scrutiny completely. Many of these individuals undoubtedly are innocent, but they should have their day in court and they should have to answer for the accusations against them, just as genocide suspects who were caught inside Rwanda had to do so in front of Gacaca.
We first reached out to Frodwaard Rukashangabo back in November.
Good afternoon. Is that Frodwaard Rukashangabo speaking?
This is Frodwaard. How are you?
Mr. Rukashangabo, my name's Ben Doherty.
The allegations have been around since articles first appeared online a few years ago, dismissed by some in the diaspora as politically motivated. Australia's small Rwandan community is deeply divided.
What is your position in this matter?
Mr. Rukashangabo, I don't have a position in this matter. I'm making no judgment about this, but these are very serious matters, and I wanted to put those to you if that was possible. Mr. Rukashangabo, are you there? He's hung up.
Last month, after our visit to Rwanda, we sent him a detailed list of the allegations against him and repeated our request for an interview. He replied,
I respectfully decline to participate in interview and the process/project.
In an earlier message, he said,
I am aware of false allegations and smear campaigns that have been aimed at myself, my family, and the extensive Rwandan refugee community over the past few years.
So I've put together this timeline on Rukashengabo.
We're not making any assumptions about the truth of these allegations, but how did someone accused of genocide in Rwanda manage to become an Australian citizen? My colleague Dunya Karagic has been looking into the effectiveness of our screening.
Okay, so his conviction happens in 2007. In 2009, he arrives in Australia, but from what you've been told, it's very likely that Australian authorities just didn't have any information about his conviction.
But Rwandan prosecutors have shown us a list, a Gacaca fugitives database that has his name on it, and that was accessible from 2012. That's 2 years before he becomes a citizen.
Yeah, so in theory, his name should have been on the Central Movement Alert List, that list used by immigration authorities to flag people of suspicion from entering the country or from getting citizenship.
So why wasn't he picked up on that list then?
I mean, we don't know for certain if he was or he wasn't, but I've spoken to several former immigration staff who've raised problems with this list.
And they're saying people just slip through the net?
Sometimes, yeah.
The man I'm going to meet knows that in the past, suspected war criminals from conflicts such as the Balkans, Sri Lanka and Cambodia have found sanctuary in Australia. Graham Blewett was the deputy prosecutor at the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia. But before that, he ran the Special Investigations Unit, established in 1987 to investigate the presence of alleged Nazi war criminals in Australia.
The final chapter today in Australia's war crime investigations. Conducted over 7 years at a cost of $17 million, not one conviction was secured.
Well, you've put 7 years of your life into this, Mr. Blewett. How do you feel tonight?
Well, it's been a long road, and I'm very disappointed that the case has ended the way they did.
Hello, Graham. Ben Doherty.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. Thanks so much for the invitation. Thank you.
Australia has no permanent investigations unit, and that's why these allegations that there are war criminals living in Australia are not attended to.
Graham points out that countries like the United States, Canada, and Great Britain do have permanent war crimes investigations units.
And if allegations arise within their country, then they are able to investigate and bring prosecutions. And these are happening.
You've seen these allegations made against two men believed to be living in Australia. What do you make of these two cases?
Just looking at the material, the allegations are certainly serious. And I believe the Australian government should do something about it. We should be part of this team, international team, bringing war criminals to justice.
The Attorney General declined our interview request, but a spokesperson said,
the Australian government is committed to tackling serious international crimes and takes allegations of genocide very seriously.
And a spokesperson for the Home Affairs Minister said,
as is long-standing practice, we do not comment on individual cases.
Still the same person in the first bit of the film with no hair, and now just bought hair. The way it works. You wake up in the morning, you've got big hair.
Frida Umahosa understands how important justice is to survivors. It's why she's been helping us look into Celestine Munyaburunga, the alleged killer from her hometown.
Hello?
Hello. Frida, it's Ben Doherty calling.
Oh, hi, Ben. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. Well, thank
for
you.
For months, we've been searching for traces of Munyaburunga in Australia, but I'm afraid we've reached a dead end. I think, you know, we identified a house in Queensland where his family lives. There's also a man of about the right age who was seen at the house. But we don't know for sure. We can't confirm that it's him, but we just don't know. And I'm not sure we'll ever know for sure.
It is disappointing, but at the same time, it's not surprising to me because it's just even like the guy who killed my father. I don't even really know where he lives. I really don't.
Nobody knows where he is.
It's 30 years since the genocide against the Tutsi. It's still really important to you that they are held to account.
I think it doesn't matter what age you are, because there's still a lot of survivors who are still living with their scars and wounds. We're all connected. All of us are connected. And what the other person felt, we have all felt. Genocide is not a crime that grows old.